parler en anglais. Hi everybody, I'm going to talk about EFMP's Extensible Symbolic Execution Tool. So first I'm going to explain what is EFMP. It's an Eclipse project. I'll explain what is the use of the symbolic execution tool, what you can do with it, how you can customize it for your needs, and I'll give an illustration of what other projects have done with our tool. So the Eclipse formal modeling project is fairly new. It's still in incubation, and our goal when we first submitted the proposal was to help spread the use of formal methods. And to do this, we thought that using Eclipse was a good idea because it will help reach lots of different people. And as a first step, we propose to help to check model properties. So the symbolic execution tool we have helps to build safer models to prevent generic mistakes. So, such as building models with unreachable states, models which have deadlocks. Our method allows to look for behaviors of interest and check that some properties are true in the model before implementing it in a system. And we provide a connection with popular SMT solver. And so what is provided is a kernel for symbolic execution, which allows to compute the possible behaviors of a system and a user interface in order to edit the model of the system and execute the analysis you want to carry out. So this is what the user interface looks like. So it's a little cluttered, but because I put everything in the same space, but basically you have a model editor which allows you to specify your system. There's a tool which allows you to configure what kind of analysis you want to carry out on your model. And then there are some windows which show you what's happening during the execution. And there's also the possibility to show on a graph what has been built during the execution of the analysis. So the underlying architecture looks like that. On the left, you have what I've shown you before, so the edition and the execution perspective. And on the right side of the slide, it is the kernel for symbolic execution and formal analysis. So that's what I'm going to focus the talk from now on. I'm going to explain how it is built and how we can use it. So, the symbolic execution platform has several elements. So, the symbolic execution kernel in and of itself. There are several formal analysis modules which are already given as examples of what can be done. And there are mechanisms to extend the existing formal analysis modules and write new ones for your precise needs. So the aim is to analyze systems built from interacting and communicating components. And we describe these components through an expressive language, which we call a XLIA, Extensible Language for Interaction and Assemblage. I will not go into detail because our aim is not to make people use this language to describe their system. We think that people should already have their model in their preferred language and be able to build a translation from their preferred language to our to XLIA, because it's expressive enough to take into account all kinds of semantics. So from the models described in our language, we execute them symbolically. So the symbolic execution algorithm is an iterative algorithm which will compute execution context. The execution contexts are the information which tell us in which state the system model is. And we simulate symbolically what can happen during the execution of the system. So, for example, if there are two possible transitions, we're going to build two execution contexts from parent execution context. So, there's a the aim is to build the execution context that can be reached from the first execution context, which is the system, its initial state. So I have a graphical. So this is how the symbolic execution algorithm works. So let's say we have already computed part of the graph, and we have a set of execution contexts which are still to be treated. So that's our waiting queue. So from this set of execution contexts, we compute the possible following steps for the system. So that's a step of symbolic execution. So here, each of the execution contexts have two possible followers, but it could be zero, it could be one, it could be a lot more. And so these new execution contexts are the result of the symbolic execution, and they become the new waiting queue to be treated in the next step. So that's the basic idea, but we're going to want to do things with the symbolic execution. It's interesting to build the graph of possible behaviors, but sometimes you want to guide it to do something precise. So, for example, you can choose in which way you want to build the graph. If you want to build it in a BFS manner, so in order to cover everything, or DFS, or random walk. And so all this is customizable. So this is how you can customize the execution. So the idea is that you can configure a set of user parameters, and then before the execution, you have a pre-process step. Afterwards, you will have a post-process, and at each step of the symbolic execution, you have a filtering mechanism. So here, I have an example where the pre-filter will help select some execution context in order to apply the chosen policy. So if you had BFS, the selection will be everything. If you had DFS, it will be the first one you built. and the post filter does nothing here. But, so the post filtering, I just show it on the example again. We have a waiting queue. The symbolic execution computes the possible next states of the system, and then we can apply post filtering. So let's assume we are trying to cover some transition of the system. So for example, tier 2, we would check if any of the transitions that were triggered by the symbolic executions are indeed tier 2, and we would just keep them and lose the rest. So now I will show you how to develop a new formal analysis module from what we've already seen. So we need to have the pre-process, and the filter, which will allow us. So I've chosen to show you on an example in order to explain better, and chosen to explain it on reachability heuristics, which is called hit or jump. So the idea is that this is all upstream work. So we are at the specification level, and let's say we want to build test sequences. So we want to exhibit a particular behavior of interest from our specification, and we will characterize it by a set of observable events, which can be states that have to be reached or transitions that have to be triggered, some messages that must be sent or received. So all these are things that we can test during the symbolic execution. So the idea is that we want to cover a sequence of events or properties, and the heuristic that we want to implement is that we will give a height during which we will do a full BFS, and in the graph that we have built this way, we will try to check if some part of the sequence is there. So if we see one, so for example here we have P1, we keep the path going through the event that we wanted to observe, and we try again to do the symbolic execution, but keeping only this path. So all the other paths are no longer an issue. And so this heuristic, sometimes you will build your BFS tree and you won't see any of the events you wanted to see. So in that case, you decide to do what's called a jump. So you pick a path at random. Hopefully you will find something that will help you. So you pick an execution context at random and you do the next step. So once again, you do BFS search. You look for your properties. You choose the path that covers the most of them, and so on. So this heuristic allows to find such sequences faster than BFS and more efficiently than a random walk. So how do we encode this heuristic in our tool? Well, first we have some user parameters. So we have to give the height of the BFS step. So that's something that the user has to give, and the sequence of properties to be covered, of course. The pre-filter is really simple. You just symbolically execute everything. So there is no selection done at the pre-filter stage. The pre-process is that, well, you have to keep in mind where you are when you build your BFS tree. So you have a variable that keeps track of in which is the height that you've computed. And you have to keep in mind for each execution context which of the properties have already been covered or not. So you instantiate these variables, and at the end of the process you will slice the graph to only keep the path of interest. So the interesting thing is the post filter. It's there that everything will the intelligence is. So the pre-filter, the post-filter will just look if anything has been covered more at this step. If something more has been covered, it will keep track of it in the variable cover index. And if everything, all the test sequence has been covered, it will stop the execution. And lastly, if we have we are at the height that was given as a parameter for our BFS execution, it will have to stop the execution and choose from a new execution context to start from at the next step. So that's what we done with the choose max coverage. And this is a way of doing that is highly customizable and highly modular. So let's imagine that instead of just wanting to keep one path, I want to keep two or more when I do a jump. Well, I only have to change two things. So I have to add this new parameter at the beginning of my process, and I have to modify the behavior when I have just reached the max height of our BFS. So the choose max coverage has to take into account that I pick more execution context to go on. So finally, as it's a little bit abstract, I wanted to help give you an intuition of how this can work and be made to cooperate with other things. So we have worked in a European project which is called Vesedia. So the aim of this project was to design safe and secure IoT using formal techniques. And so the problem was that the requirements are often at the system level, and the requirements must be verified all the way to the code level. So there must be a tool support to assess safety and security at the code level, but based on the requirements at the specification level. So the challenge was to translate the high-level requirements into low-level verification. And so the idea is to use an approach which goes from a model, which is very high level, and which will compute properties to be verified on the code. So the models that were used in this case were sequence diagrams, which allowed to explain the interactions of the system at without many details. And from these sequence diagrams, we built an automatic tooling that generated the low-level requirements. So the high-level model was made in Papyrus, and then we had a translation into our language. So as I said earlier, it would have been possible, of course, to write the specification in our language, but that's not, we don't think it's the way most people will want to use it. So there was a translation from the high level specification to our language, and then there was a formal analysis module which was specifically designed in order to generate low level requirements that were used as input for a tool that does code verification at the C level, and who needed to have very 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 detailed requirements, such as some values which should be which had to be within given bracket. And so we were able to build this with existing tools and by customizing our platform. So as a conclusion, so EFMP, the Eclipse Formal Modeling Project, is an open platform for formal analysis. So at the moment, there's only the symbolic execution tool, but if anybody wanted to add a component, we would be glad to add it. We have a fully customizable kernel of symbolic execution, and it's extensible to, and it allows to develop new analysis techniques. There's a list of projects that in which we are involved, and where we hope to develop new things. I've given the links to the website, but it's still in incubation. We've only just found out how we could update the website easily, so everything is not yet there. So if you have any questions or remarks, or I'd be happy to hear them. Yes.
So I just had a look on your on the website, There's a long history of previous tools and approaches, which this doesn't really give an impression of. So you're building on this long history of other tools and approaches, SDL and the like. So what are the, is there a progression? Is it, I'm thinking, you know, are we getting further along being able to use this, these approaches in normal situations, or in non-security critical, safety critical situations?
We hope so. We think the Eclipse project is a step towards reaching new people, but yes, the tool is based on a lot of previous work by CEA, which was not used really a lot outside of academia, so which was a pity. But what, that's your question?
Yes. Is ease of use?
Yes.
Is it easy enough to use?
Well, I'm not the best person qualified to do it, to tell you. We've certainly tried to. We think there's a nice editing and executing framework which really helps, especially the configuration part, which was a kind of difficult to do even for experts. So, for example, we have chosen some specific for analysis that people can pick and choose, and there are a lot of options that we have hidden in order to make it clearer. And now, people we're waiting for people to come with their with their models and tell us if it's enough or not. Yes. Yes.
What is the coverage of the translation from the models that you can do in Paris to learn English? What's the coverage?
It depends, because you know the models you can do in UML. So first, only the behavioral models will have will make sense to translate. So state machines, or sequence diagrams, or activity diagrams. State machines are have a semantic that seems very near the one we have. But UML does not impose a semantics, so it really depends on what semantics you put on UML. But we have something that works for sequence diagrams, for a semantic that seems to make sense for us, and state machines as well. So thank you. In the project I talked about, it was we used a tool that's called Framasy, which does code verification by using annotation. And the idea is that you have it's kind of like in the whole logic, you know, you have pre conditions and post conditions, and the I believe the kind of things that were checked was things about the timing and some values which should not go outside some bounds. But I have to. I can tell you more sometime. Yes. To do the translation, we haven't used a dedicated tool. We wrote a plugin in Java, I think. So we wrote a Java plugin that was only for us. So maybe there's something more smarter to do there. I don't know, but. Sorry, could you repeat? Yes. No? Well, if you have any question later, don't hesitate.